In a high-stakes business climate that demands huge sales from artists' releases, there is intense pressure on artists to stay hot with fans. Because sometimes, just making good music isn't enough.
Masterfully, I would say, LL's longevity has to do with him mastering the game. He'll put out a record with Boyz II Men that's a love song, that's gonna chart without question, and sell the album. Now, to the perception on the street, it's like, what is he doing, blah, 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 blah. But to the industry, it's still another platinum album. What he also does on the album is he would do collaboration with some new street cats, the 4321 with DMX and Canibus, which is how the battle with him and Canibus began.
In the late 90s, Canibus was an up-and-coming MC with a reputation for lyricism and a few noteworthy records. Clearly among a handful of promising talent, he was asked to collaborate with Method Man, Redman, DMX, and Master P for LL Cool J's 4321.
L was like a father figure in rap music, and I was just somebody who was coming in the game. I mean, I had done other records prior to 4321, but I was somebody who was coming in the game and was really looking for somebody to be under their wing and rock with them and tear the whole game down with them from the inside out.
As a longtime listener and fan, Canibus knew that LL Cool J had tattooed a microphone on his right arm.
First thing I looked for was the mic. When I saw it, I was like, damn, you know, when you see the mic, and you know what it represents, you know that for anybody to put a mic on their arm, when I'm saying that, damn, this is my life, or this is something that I do very well, something that I did very well, and I'm doing very well, or, you know, it's a statement.
While recording 4321, Canibus wrote a verse suggesting that he wanted to borrow the mic from LL's arm. After hearing Canibus rhyme, LL recorded a response, potentially creating a battle within the song 4321.
Because he couldn't see what was in my heart. If anything, you know, that should have seemed like something that was probably flattering.
Nobody ain't took it like that, but I guess, you know what I'm saying? Because I don't think Canibus was going. I mean, come on, I knew Canibus. I mean, even before he was getting on, Canibus used to just come spit with the squad all the time, you know what I mean? So he ain't had that attitude of trying to get on and diss anybody. I know that for a fact.
You throw something in the cage, you rattle his cage. He ain't got time to break it down what you meant.
I'll take that mic off your arm.
No. You asked to borrow the mic. Asked to borrow it. He was doing it as a flatter.
This is the debate right here. LL is a cultural icon. You don't come out your face and no, you don't borrow nothing. You lucky to be on the racket.
Perhaps trying to avoid an ongoing battle, LL told Canibus that if he wanted to stay on the track, he would have to rewrite his rhyme. Canibus agreed and rewrote the rhymes, thinking LL would do the same. He didn't.
Still on my arm is off limits to challenges. You hold the rusty swords, I swing the Excalibur.
He took something out of context and he ran with it. You know, it's like he always been that way. You heard Break It Down.
Now let's get back to this mic on my arm. If it ever left my side, it transformed into a time bomb. You don't want to bar that. You want to idolize. And you don't want to make me mad. You want to socialize.
With Canibus's mic verse off the track, LL argued that no one would know who he was talking about. But rumors and copies of the original recordings began to spread around New York. The pressure to answer the disrespect mounted on Canibus in an allegedly taped phone conversation widely circulated on the internet. Canibus was told that the two might publicly squash the beef by doing an underground track together. All Canibus had to do was wait 2 months for LL to become available.
Niggas is not running around the country knowing about this situation. You got 50 niggas in New York that are in the industry running around running their fucking mouths.
You called me earlier, right?
Yeah.
Okay. You know what I was doing? I was on the internet. I'm telling you that in Wyoming, niggas is talking about it. I'm telling you that in Texas, niggas is talking about it. In North Dakota.
You're talking about it, dog. You get what you want to do? You want to add fuel to the fire? You want to?
Nah.
You want to address it? I mean, what do you want me to say?
I don't want to address the situation. I don't want to do what niggas is out there feeling. Yo, Canibus, nigga, I don't want to do that.
The reality is, mentally and emotionally, are you capable of standing the pressure until it comes the time when we can make something happen, when we can kill a noise?
Your career could end if you lose a battle. for some people, that's how they perceive it. Especially with people that are coming into the rap game.
Those opportunities to rock, those were my windows to my dream. That was the window to my dream.
The fact that you feel and people are pressuring you to feel almost disrespected or slighted to a certain extent. That nigga's fucking sticking you to the fork to mouth. Yo, you need to write a 7-hour rhyme about L. Right. Are you capable of standing the pressure mentally and emotionally? Are you capable of standing the pressure? People are pressuring you to feel almost disrespected.
You want me to let the world know the truth? You don't want me to shine. You study my rhyme. Then you lay your vocals at the mine. That's a bitch move.
Canibus counterattacked with second round knockout.
Eat MC'd for lunch.
You walk around showing off your body cause it sells. Plus to avoid the fact that you ain't got scales. Mad at me cause I kick that shit real, niggas fail. 99% of your fans wear high heels.
Go for yours, dude. Go for yours. And who better than LL Cool J, the greatest of all time.
I studied your background, read the book that you wrote, researched your footnotes about how you used to sniff coke, fronting like a drug-free role model. You disgust me. I know bitches that see you smoke weed recently.
How can someone proclaim one thing and then off the record do another? You know, if you can somehow point that out, I mean, in a lyrical way, and still keep the emotion going, then that'll make a good diss record.
And if you really want to show off, we could get it on live in front of the cameras on your own sitcom. I let you kick a verse, fuck it, I let you kick them all. I'll even wait for the studio audience to applaud. Now watch me rip the tap from your arm, kick you in the groin, stick you for your Vanguard award in front of your mom. Your first, second, and third born, make your wife get on the horn, call Minister Farrakhan so he can persuade me to squash it. I say no, he started it, he forgot what a hardcore artist is.
Everybody was really like, uh-oh, like this is it. You know what I'm saying? Like, LL finally met his match.
But LL Cool J wasn't finished.
Can I bust? Yeah, yeah. Can I bust? Yeah, yeah. Don't ever open your mouth and mention my seed. Talk about my book, you bought to
LL
read.
And Leo Cullen realized it was a great opportunity, you know, to kind of jump in there, kickstart, restart LL's career and get him a lot of buzz. And it really did that for LL Cool J.
Cannabis, he ain't understanding this. 99% of his fans don't exist.
Fans were excited to hear LL Cool J's return to the battle.
He did a lot more with his energy, and he seemed more intense, and it made it look in balance, like, you know, he was a superstar and Canibus is like a young kid coming up. But then when you listen to the content, it was like, I'm not grabbing my nuts saying, yeah, did you hear what he said?
Despite the fact that many fans still consider Second Round Knockout one of the best diss tracks in history, the perception was that LL had defeated Canibus in battle.
In the long run, L was just too much for him. You know, he just was too much for Canibus, you know?
Nobody ever played Canibus out on the mic, indoor, outdoor, you know, on record.
Was it LL's aggressive style that put him on top? His iconic status?
Nowadays, because of media and things like that, you gotta be careful on who you jump on, because a company like a Def Jam or somebody at a Universal Music System, they have more suasion than other companies.
I got a mic on my arm too, as an ode to the life of Canibus or the ambition of Canibus, you know?
Whether or not the battle with LL Cool J hurt Canibus's career, it certainly helped LL Cool J's. In fact, LL Cool J even thanked Canibus in the liner notes of his Greatest of All Time album.
You know, what's so fucked up, L, is like I always looked up to you,